it would appear, thousand points of light not yet dimmed by encroaching light pollution. And I would lie outside for hours, just gazing into the night. I'd imagine my unknown ancestors looking up at Sirius, our brightest star, and being as transfixed by its brilliant blue beauty as I was thousands of years later. I'd imagine other beings on planets around other stars looking up at their own skies and imagining beings like myself on worlds beyond their own. I'd wonder how the universe had arranged itself in such a way that I could see so much beauty in these lights shining within darkness, and I feel grateful that it had. Someone once asked me how I could possibly not be impressed by how insignificant humanity is in comparison to the cosmos, and honestly, the thought never occurred to me, because lying under the blanket of night, I felt immeasurably small in the arms of the infinite, and I took comfort in that, because it meant that no matter what I did, I couldn't possibly mess up bad enough for the universe to know this. Reasons that I could not control and could not understand, the stars were one constant, and I was alone. The stars were a tangible connection with something greater than myself. I still feel that connection, even now that I'm a PhD student, going into my third year studying physics and astronomy at UNC Chapel. In my studies, I've learned so much about how intimately connected we are to the universe and to each other. Now, I know there are people this morning who are science buffs, and I also know there are people here who get kind of freaked out by science. And I want to tell you that both of those responses are okay. I want to hold this space for all of you and invite all of you in this morning to explore some of these things with me. So, to kind of start, I'd like to return to the sense of deep connection with something big, this connection I've felt since childhood. The sense of deep connection that we feel to each other and to our universe, it's not necessarily some made up thing. In a way, it's very real. The physics term for it is quantum entanglement. It's simpler than you might guess. The idea is this. You have two particles that can interact or become entangled, so that if one particle changes, the other particle will respond by changing the same way. Now, they have to be close together to get entangled, but once they do, they stay entangled. Particles would become oxidized in the universe, so far away that life would take billions of years to go from one particle to the other. And yet, if one particle changes, the other particle knows instantly and changes in response, as if they were not separated at all. I've been using this word particles a lot, so let me explain what these things are. These are the unfathomably small particles that make up atoms. Atoms make up molecules. Molecules make up the Earth and our bodies. So we're made out of these particles that remain connected to each other across space and time. Now, this idea sounds really abstract, but experiments have shown that this is actually how the universe works. And the implications of it are profoundly beautiful. Philosopher of science Robert Minot and physicist Menas Kaptos describe it like this. All particles in the history of the cosmos have interacted with other particles in the manner revealed by the experiments. Even the atoms in our bodies are made up of particles that were once in close proximity to the cosmic fireball. If this is the case, the universe, on a very basic level, could be a vast flood of particles which remain in contact. Philosopher Jeffrey Crichton puts it more succinctly, I really like the way he puts it. It is as if everything is already one thing and is simply responding to itself. It is as if everything is already one thing and is simply responding to itself. It's not really the case that any of us are truly separate from each other, that we exist separately from the rest of the universe. We are the universe. The particles that make up each of us are all part of this cosmic web of interaction. We are never truly isolated, never truly alone. Now, I've said in passing that these particles make up atoms, and that everything we see is made of atoms. But there are many, many different kinds. the beginning, there are no galaxies, no stars, no light, just these teeny tiny bits of mere matter. And you can't have planets like Earth out of hydrogen. So there were no planets, because the heavier elements of the planets did not yet exist. Over eons, vast numbers of these little atoms of hydrogen bump into clouds. The clouds coalesced into the first stars. Stars take atoms of hydrogen, fuse them together to make atoms of helium. That's how they get their energy. Helium exists because stars use hydrogen. Now, when stars use up all their stored hydrogen, they fuse helium instead and create new, heavier elements like oxygen and carbon. Then, when stars run out of helium, they fuse heavier and heavier elements, carbon, nitrogen, calcium, oxygen, the everyday elements we know about. They keep fusing these heavy elements until at last they don't have the energy to fuse anything heavier than iron. And so, the universe's first stars died, and they could no longer fuse anything. Upon their deaths, these stars exploded and sent their heavy elements flying out into the universe. These elements that did not exist until their birth in the first stars fired forwards. These new heavy elements met with other clouds emerging in the universe. These clouds condensed into stars, just like the first stars, except a lot of the bits of clouds around these new stars contain heavy elements too, like oxygen and carbon. And so when the heavy elements swirling around new stars, for the first time, planets would form from carbon, iron, and silicon ash of the old stars. For at least one star in the universe, one planet formed that harbors life, ours. Now I'm going to take what I just said and really analyze it. Think through all the implications, feel the truth of it. We breathe oxygen with it. Our cells are made mostly of carbon. Our DNA is made of nitrogen. Our bones are made of calcium. Our blood is red because it's made of iron. And these elements did not exist until a star created them. I'd like to have you look down on the floor. So the carpet, that's made of stardust. The ground beneath the carpet, that's also made of stardust. I'd like to invite you to look down your hands. Notice the lines of your palms, the backs of your hands, your nails. So remember, our cells are made of carbon, our bones are made of calcium, our blood is made of iron. When you look down at your hands, you are looking at stardust. You are made of stardust. And I'd like to invite you now to kind of shift your gaze to the people on the screen. Look to the person to your right. That's not the opposite. Look to the person to your left. Look to the person in front of you. Look to the person in this room who looks different from you in some way. Perhaps different age, different color, different gender. It's okay if that person is me. Everyone you see around you is made of stardust, just like you. We are all made of the same cloud of stardust that we are planet. The stardust that made all creatures, from dinosaurs to house cats. The stardust that is the dirt we walk upon and the air we breathe. How do you feel when you look at your hands now? How do you feel when you look around and know that everything exists because the stardust have died and been reborn through us? I get chills just thinking about it. Let's explore now the idea that we're all made from the same stardust. So, all life on Earth came from the same cloud of stardust. All the same atoms on our planet have been recycled over and over again for billions of years. Now, the first life forms loaded these atoms into DNA. Then, over eons, infinite forms of life evolved from those first beginnings. So, where there once was one molecule of DNA, there are now uncountably many species that all evolved from that 98% part DNA for them. But what about other humans? How much DNA do unrelated humans share with each other? The best figure that I can find is that unrelated humans differ from each other by only about 1/10 of 1% of their DNA. 1/10 of 1%. That means all unrelated humans are 99.9% exactly the same. We are all basically identical. No other species comes close. Whoever we are, whomever we love, wherever we are from, whatever we look like, whatever we believe, we are all more closely related to each other than we are to any other creature in the entire universe. We are all each other's family. There are no other humans anywhere else in the universe. We are the only ones. That's it. It's just us. In Carl Sagan's words, every one of us is, in cosmic perspective, precious. If a human disagrees with you, let him live. Because of 100 billion galaxies, you will not find another. Now, of course, I didn't know any of this when I used to stargaze in my backyard. I just knew that I felt comforted by the night sky. Frankly, my decision to come to town was all Carl Sagan's fault. Because once I learned from him that we are all made of stardust, it changed everything. I remember being in a moment of deep despair at that time, and I remember looking at my hands and being moved to tears by the miracle of my own existence. In a universe of exploding stars, a universe where every fiber of our beings are connected to every fiber of the universe,